So I'm going to try my attempt. I think that my time has already started counting. I'm going to talk about the chaos and order, but the first thing I want to talk about is thank you so much for hearing me and seeing me. What is the population of India? 200 million? 250 million? They still don't see me, man. And I'm going to talk about it, the chaos of the binary gender that we see across in India. Most of the times when we talk about in India, we only talk about the people who are either male or female, and we don't go beyond that. Why don't you do one thing? Why don't you try to touch base with you, the first instance that you had with the transgender person or a hijra person? So, was it fear? Maybe, some people may have. Some people must have felt, nah? Poor these people. My God, what has gone wrong with them? How insulting it is to be a transgender. Mystery, who are these people? Who are these people? Where do they come from? How do they become like that? Shame that these people are living like that in life. Well, what I'm going to talk about is the lost world for you guys. I'm going to talk about the invisible community. This is some of the quotes that I want to just read out to you, and these are the real quotes. I was beaten up by my own father and thrown out of my house. I had no choice but to run away from my house and just to run away from the house so that I don't put my family to a shame. And this is a quote given by a transgender person. I was raped by my friends. When I went to a police and I went to an educational institute, when I went back and actually reported to my teacher actually said to me that there's nothing wrong with them. They're perfectly normal. The problem is with you. You are acting something strange. This is not how you should be acting. And if you don't act like that, people will not kind of harass you. Well, there are many of us, if we don't go for a sex work in a day, probably will not be able to eat the full meal in a day. And that's the harsh reality of it. The harsh reality of it is that at this point of time, I'm working at the national and international level, and still I stay in slum. Why would that be? I wonder, is it the ignorance from the society, or is it something wrong with me? And that's the truth about it. This is one of my favorite. This is my Nati Chela, means I'm a guru, my Chela's Chela. And he's an engineering student. He's from Bangalore, he's an engineering student, he's there with us. And the only way he survives to live in this society is to beg on the street. And I keep saying to him that, why do you have to beg on the street? The basic thing about it that he's not been able to cope up with the eyes of the people that you see across in the people. And the last but not least is that a lot of these people keep drinking and having substance use just to kill themselves because they don't want to be judged. Right from the day they have got up until the day they sleep, and after also the sleep. Plus point about is that this is not new to our society. A lot of us think that these people are alien people. Transgender people, hijra peoples are the alien people, and these are something different to that. But there are cultural references that you see across. Manusmriti, Atharva Shastra, all the things that you see across in India, they talk about it that India has been beyond binary genders. It was beyond men and women. There was always a third gender. There was always a cross-dressing. I'm going to talk about it. These are some of the references that you see across. Kliba, Pandaba, Napunsaka, these are the names that has been given by Atharva Shastra and other Shastras, which talks about that India has been always so rich about this. Where do you see a sexual act carved in on the temple? You see that across in any of the world? I don't think so. This is the only India that we have. We are the leaders who has given the zero to the entire world. Unfortunately, the amount of transphobia and homophobia that we have in our India is still, it is very, very difficult. Now, many times, you know, kind of people get confused between transgenders and sexual identity people. Many times if you see a transgender, people say, that's a gay person, but that's not the truth. You need to understand that one of the issue is that gay, lesbian, bisexual people are something which is called a sexual orientation or sexual preference. However, when we talk about transgender, it is much to do with gender. So you actually complete a journey from one gender to another gender. You change your gender from one gender to another gender, and it has nothing to do with sexuality as such. So next time when you see such kind of people, just try to have that different. This is some of the evidences that you guys already know, and I'm not going to dwell about it, but I just thought I will take out from the epics, just to help you understand that there has been always a third gender in India. Okay, transgender is a sort of a, you know, bigger umbrella. A lot of people feel that only when we talk about transgender or third gender, the only identity that come across to your mind is hijras. But that's not true. Transgender is a larger umbrella. Now, what you see in a transgender people, transgender, which means that somebody who doesn't belong to his gender or her gender. So it happens both the ways. You could be born as a male with the male genitals, and then you could change your complete sexual orientation to become a female. And at the same time, you could be born with a female gender, and you could change your complete orientation towards a male. And this could happen both the ways. There are very few people who is born with the genital deformity, which is called as intersex people. And those numbers are, out of 5 lakhs people, only one person is born like that. So all these people who are actually born with some kind of genitals, they change their gender over the period of time. What is required is the biggest thing that required for them is the family support. But do they get the family support? Let's have a look at it. Now, at this point of time, the numbers that we are having available in India about transgenders is around 4 lakhs population. So you have all this population which is mapped in the census of India, but they don't have job and they don't have equal opportunity to live in a society. What you see across is that when we talk about Indian culture, before British invasion, before India actually came into an attack situation from the various other forces like Britain and France and Portuguese and other people, India has been a very secular country. India has been a very, very progressive country. All the third gender people were having a very prominent positions in the kingdoms and the Mughals and other related aspects. They were protector of the harems. They were makeup artists. Some of them were cooks. Some of them were advisor to the kings and queens. So they were having a very important positions in the society. What happens after the British law? All these people were actually shunned down from the society under the Tribal Act. They were thrown out from the societies. And that's the reason why this vicious circle of them coming to a picture where the entire gamut of vulnerability has started. So what is that you really require in people like that? A family support. But do we get a family kind of support for these people? No. Nobody would like to have a hijra person, transgender person in the house, right? It is shame to them. When we have a transgender or hijra person coming to our houses, we say that, "Arey bhaiya, de do, inko par jaane do. Let them go. Just don't," because it is a shame for them. We feel that they are something wrong, they are something bad people who are coming to our society and making the society really a big culprit. And many times we don't have an open eye. We don't look the binary of the chemical locha, I say, the binary chemical locha and the chaos of the binary structure and see that these people could also worth be calling as a human being. And a lot of times we ignore them. There are around 85% of people who do not get a family support. What happens when you don't get a family support? You run away from the house, you reach to a alien state, and what do you do there? You have nothing to do. You can either beg or either you can do a sex work. Even if you are educated, even if you have education, you still cannot pursue your education or neither go for an employment. The data says that you see that it's not that people are not educated among transgenders. There are educated people. Unfortunately, they do not have the equal opportunity that I can have. Fortunately, all of you who are sitting here has family support or either has a good grades who can come here and study here. Majority of people that belong to my community cannot face themselves, cannot face the society, and neither can come across to the educational background and actually say that I want an education. And that's the biggest problem. So you are actually talking about the world which is visible, but for you it is invisible. Right now, the kind of the amount of survival that these people are having is only sex work and begging. And begging is also, we previously used to have a nuclear families where there used to be a lot of auspicious reasons where people can come and they can do some ceremonial dance and get some amount of money and survive from that. But now we have gone from the bigger families to a smaller families. We have a child control. There is no major occasions where happy occasions like my gendered people can come to your houses and earn money. So where do they stay? How do they survive? They only get into the money from the sex work. Many times these people don't even get an opportunity to treat their own illnesses, and that's the biggest thing. The situation they are living into is a substandard situation. They stay in a slum area, and many times you know, they face the vulnerable violence from the community people. So this is the violence data that you see it across. Almost 50% of them do face a violence from all these people. The violence begins from their home. The violence begins from their mother and father and their brothers and sisters. They don't have to go out to face the violence. The violence can face from their entire house. And that transit further to the various level. It goes to the police, it goes to the goons. So when you're out and open, it's like an open wound. You know, every time somebody touches, you're gonna bleed. And that's what the situation these people are having at this point of time in a society. Well, what we have done is that we have really, really worked with the government. We have worked with policymakers. Fortunately, in Supreme Court in 2014, April, they released the third gender order. What does that mean? That Supreme Court acknowledged that there are more than two genders which are existing in a society. And these people has to be given equal opportunity, these people has to be given equal rights, and these people has to be given dignity. Unfortunately, and these orders were that within 6 months this work has to happen. But unfortunately, there was a time when India was transitioning from one government to another government. The new government which came into the existence filed a writ petition again, saying that, you know, who are these people? We don't know. When there's a clear-cut instruction, these people has to be provided a support under the category of other backward class. So if they are already other backward class and if they are transgenders, do you give them a double kind of leverage or what? So the entire thing is thrown back to the Supreme Court. Probably Supreme Court will take another 5 to 10 years, and the work that we have done for over the years with the policymaker is gone into the vein. Now what we need is a movement from you and me. What we need is a movement from the people who are sitting across in this auditorium and the larger cortex. Many times people come to me and they say to me, I remember one instance, I must tell you about that. I was talking to a bunch of doctors like that, and one of the doctors who came and who said to me that, Abhina, what are you talking about the vulnerability of transgenders and hijra people? It's not that, you're just making it out. It's not a big deal about it. You know, we can definitely employ them. And I tell them, doctor, how many transgenders you have employed in your own house? Would you prefer to adopt a transgender kid to your own house? Would you prefer to have healthcare workers within your healthcare setting who could be a transgenders? Why can't Indigo have a transgender air hostess? Why can't we have a transgender professors? Why can't we have a transgender cook? But the fact remains is that transgender people do not have the equal opportunities. And that equal opportunities has to be given to them at this point of time. The unfortunate part about it is that none of us are understanding the severity of this issue, because for us, they are always on the third corner. For us, they are always somebody who's not in my part. And I think the change has to begin within. It cannot happen outside. What we need at this point of time is support from all of you. What we need is that a lot of welfare scheme that needs to be happen for the transgender people. And a lot of them has to start within your institute, within your homes, within your local areas, and within your known people. So before you understand that transgenders could have a change, the change has to begin inside your mind of removing the transphobia and accepting them as a normal human being. Well, this is the story I must tell you about it. Her name is Simran Sheikh. She was a sex worker when we found her in 2007 and 2008. We worked with her very, very closely. She was instrumental in initiating the first organization called as the Eye Welfare Society in India, Mumbai. And her work started then. And we did a lot of capacity building with her over the period of time, because she was almost like 12 past, 13 past kind of a person. Belongs to a family, Parsi family, ran away from the Parsi family, very well-known Parsi family, because Parsi family didn't want to accept her at this point of time. There was a huge amount of opportunities given to her, capacity building given to her, and also people gave a lot of acceptance. And as a result of that, you see her in Satyamev Jayate with Amir Khan. And that's the biggest change. That this is a quite vital change that you see it across. If a sex worker can make it to a Satyamev Jayate show, I mean, I feel that 4,000 transgenders who are there in India can definitely make it. What they need is equal opportunity and rights. Now I'm going to take back to the circle that I talked to you in the beginning. Let's just hit on that. You remember this circle? What we need is employment. What we need is education. What we need is acceptance. And before that, what we need is a dignity from all of you. In that entire chaos, now we have started a discussion about chaos and order. In this entire discussion about chaos and order, what I see it across is a ray of hope. A ray of hope that has to be given by all of you to people like me to stand up, raise, and actually work towards our own betterment. Before I could finish, I just want to, there's one specific song that I really, really like, that I keep motivating me, because at the age of 13, when I was going through my transition and my gender issues, I did not have any sort of a positive role model. The first transgender I see on the while I was going to a school was begging on the street. And when I saw that, I said, oh my gosh, my future is going to be like that. I'm going to stand on a signal and I'm going to beg. What happens to the values that my family has given me? What happens to the what happens to my mother and father who's really raising me with a lot of love and care? And I said, no. If there is no leader who can create a change from the binary structure, so be it. I'm going to be the one, and I'm going to bring the change to the society. Let me introduce myself. My name is Abhina Aher. I'm a transgender hijra person. I have started my career as a peer educator distributing condoms on the field. At this point of time, I'm an elected chair of Asia Pacific Transgender Network, and I handle the Asia Pacific countries. And if I can make it, I'm sure thousands of these transgender people out there who can make it, what they need is your hand. I'm gonna sing two lines of this song, which I really like, and I keep humming all the time. In fact, while I was coming to the Rex Award also, I was humming about it. I hope you like it, and I hope you appreciate it. I still have 17 seconds left.
Ye hausla kaise jhuke, ye arzu kaise ruke, ye hausla kaise jhuke, ye arzu kaise ruke, manzil mushkil to kya, dhundla sahil to kya, tanha ye dil to kya ho, ye hausla kaise ruke, ye arzu kaise jhuke, raah pe kaate bikhre agar, us pe to phir bhi chalna hi hai, shaam chupaye suraj agar, raat ko ek din dhalna hi hai, rut ye tal jayegi, himmat rang aayegi, subah phir aayegi ho, ye hausla kaise jhuke, ye aarzu kaise thame, ye aarzu kaise thame, ye aarzu kaise thame.